What? The police here?
Huh? Huh?
What? The police here?
Huh?
Stop it! Who told you to fire? Put your guns down now! Stop it! Who told you to fire? Freeze!
Get your hands up!
I'm entitled to diplomatic immunity. I want to talk to the person in charge here.
Taking classified programmers out of the country compromises national security. We can also have you brought up on kidnapping charges. You have no choice. Let him go.
Not possible. Mr. Dida wants political asylum from us, and we have his signed affidavit.
What?
I don't have to explain. The affidavit is at the embassy. I'll send you a copy in a couple of days.
Dida, you'll be killed if you return.
I'm warning you to watch your comments. Our country is a peace-loving democracy.
Of course it is.
Our country is a peace-loving democracy.
Of course it is.
The window! Shoot! The window! Shoot!
I don't believe it. Thermoptic camouflage. I don't believe it. Thermoptic camouflage.
Major, they came in early. Damn it. The SWAT guys are in my way.
We are known as the Individual 11. Even if we have failed today in our mission, the individual ego shall carry on our collective will. Therefore, the threat of death means nothing to our people.
You don't say. Well then, go ahead and die.
Outside the window!
Let's talk about Ghost in the Shell. Before we get to the movies, let's discuss the source material. Written and drawn by Masamune Shirow, Ghost in the Shell was serialized from 1989 to 1990. It consisted entirely of 11 chapters until two sequels, Man-Machine Interface and Human Error Processor, were published over a decade later. The story of Ghost in the Shell doesn't follow a typical narrative structure. Each chapter is a self-contained story with its own conflict and topic of interest. The first chapter, which clocks in at just 7 pages in length, focuses on politics. It shows the iconic opening sequence of the movie where Motoko carries out an incredibly gory assassination and then disappears using thermo camouflage. The focus of this story isn't the assassination itself, it's how future technology has constricted politics into a nightmare of bureaucratic red tape. The bulk of the chapter is a conversation where Chief Aramaki attempts to arrest some foreign diplomats after secretly surveying them, and the criminals claim diplomatic immunity. The first chapter eloquent.
Holy shit!
Well, I guess that would explain it. I won't go over every single chapter in the manga, but I will say that the chapters seem to focus on one of three things. Some chapters focus on politics, such as Chapter 10, Brain Drain, which primarily deals with Motoko going on trial for a botched operation, which resulted in the death of a target meant to be extracted. Some chapters focus on technology, such as Chapter 5, Megatech Machine 2, which is just a lengthy explanation of how a cyborg is created, and also has a lot more sexy nurses than the film version. Chapter 6 similarly focuses on technology, as some kidnapped girls infect love dolls with malicious code causing the androids to become violent and attack their owners. They do this hoping to lead the police to a love doll manufacturer and save them from captivity. Chapter 2, which isn't in the film at all, contains a lot of world building. It focuses on the technology within the story and the politics it encompasses. In this chapter, Motoko's team is tasked to investigate a cyber brainwashing facility, where the government takes children and literally reprograms them with brainwashing devices. device to produce politicians, critics, and other individuals to keep a corrupt government afloat. Because this story is self-contained to just one chapter, it isn't particularly important. It touches on politics briefly, has zero philosophy, but it does introduce several key technologies that will be reoccurring in the manga, the films, and the TV show. In addition to the iconic fuchikomas and armored suits, we see how people hack into databases, not with a computer, but with cyber brains, and what can happen when someone runs into an attack barrier. This chapter introduces us to Motoko and her team known as Section 9. Section 9 is a secret task force meant to perform illegal operations that otherwise couldn't be carried out. Motoko mentions the not-so-legality of her profession when she points out how she can't officially make an arrest without any evidence or warrants. A topic which happens to be especially relevant in today's world of CCTV cameras, Prism, botnets like Windows 10, Google, Amazon, Facebook, and the NSA and CIA curb-stomping everyone's rights to privacy in the 21st century. This chapter also introduces us to a key piece of technological communication, brain diving. In this world, human brains have become augmented to the point where you no longer need a phone or computer to talk to others, but you can do so with a sort of digital telepathy. Motoko gives her team a mission briefing, not by talking to them, but by allowing them to dive into her cyberbrain. This is a way of communicating vast amounts of information instantaneously, which may sound familiar if you've seen The Matrix. More importantly, we see that by allowing people to dive into her brain, Motoko becomes vulnerable. In addition to the information Motoko wants to share with them, they're able to gather information she doesn't want to share with them, including how she feels both physically and emotionally. This technology, often referred to as a cyberbrain, is key to the narrative of Ghost in the Shell. Brain diving likens the human brain to a computer's CPU, and allowing a stranger to access it can be a lot like letting a hacker put malicious code into your computer. Hackers can run programs in the background of your brain without your knowledge, or hackers can straight up fry your brain via remote assassination. This is worth stressing because the climax of the film is a brain dive, and you should understand the risks Motoko takes when she dives into a notorious hacker's cyberbrain. While some chapters focus on politics and some focus on technology, a few focus on philosophy. These chapters are the ones that deal with the puppeteer, in the films known as the puppet master. These philosophical chapters make up a relatively brief part of the manga, but they're the primary focus of the 1995 film. What you may not know about Masamune Shirow is that he's a total recluse. He's never made a public appearance or been photographed. Despite this, I think it's relatively easy to gauge what kind of a guy he is. Ghost in the Shell seems to be a reflection of his personal interests. The guy has some pet spiders, and in the manga, the heroes drive around in giant think tanks that look like armored spiders, complete with a sticky thread that can be used to rappel from buildings. The manga is also peppered with numerous footnotes. Some of them are a little childish. They show that Shirow is occasionally lazy or notices logical fallacies and rather point them out instead of changing them. After this, there's a scene where Motoko takes over the driving and Togusa checks the gear and puts it on, but it was too much of a hassle to draw, so I left it out. What the fuck? Yeah, thanks, Shiro. It's super important that I knew the tongues and genitals have already had the sensory solution applied. Good thing you left that footnote there. Motoko also partakes in a lesbian orgy in the manga. I think the only reason these pages were in the manga at all is because Shiro wanted to illustrate what happens when a cyberbrain experiences moji bake. You may have occasionally come across a page on the internet written in another language, a language not installed on your PC, which then causes replacement characters or private use areas to display. Well, that's what happens to Bato when his male body tries to display female sensations, which results in a visual representation of Motoko's body being literally broken apart. Shiro famously said the only reason it was an all-female orgy was because he, quote, didn't want to draw some guy's butt. While the film is pretty serious, Shiro's thoroughness and tendency to go off on tangents can be a little silly at times. Perhaps if he had control over the 1995 film, it would have been very different from what we got. With that out of the way, let's get down to the 1995 film directed by basset hound lover Mamoru Oshii. There are a couple key differences between the film and the manga. The film focuses heavily on Cartesian philosophy and the puppet master, whereas the manga does not. The first chapter of the manga and the opening scene of the film play out beat for beat, right down to the same key dialogue being used, but with one key difference. In the manga, the diplomats are discussing trade agreements and monetary reparations being given to the Gavel Republic. In the film, they're talking about Project 2501, which we don't know yet, but is actually the puppet master.
That's why you need me, right?
Depends on how you look at it.
At any rate, any program has its bugs, and I would think that a man of your capability could cure our problem.
You don't understand. We aren't even sure that Project 2501 really is a bug. Originally, the purpose of this project was to...
Major Kusanagi, Section 6 is in position and ready to move in.
Aside from a few chapters, the puppeteer isn't actually the focus of the manga, but he is the focus of the movie. Oshii took several scenes, such as the assassination and the scene where Motoko apprehends a garbage man, and retooled them so the puppet master was at the helm. He also cut out entire chapters because they weren't related to the puppet master. The film is very streamlined. It cuts the fat from the manga, shortens a lot of the dialogue, but keeps the same beats and often reiterates entire snippets word for word. One of the biggest changes between the manga and the film is its tone. The manga has very simplified cartoony characters. They often make bug eyes and silly faces. In chapter 4, the Fuchikomas have a silly discussion about having a revolution where they take over humanity.
Fellow Fuchikomas, lend me your antennae.
What is it this time?
As AI beings, our ability to process information is far superior to that of the humans. We're stronger, more standardized, we can be copied easily, and our life cycle is longer.
Yeah!
Oh, shit, man!
Let us therefore defeat the humans in one fell swoop and create our own perfect AI world. Let us cast off our chains.
And then what?
Yeah, what?
And then? We'll have a revolution.
Any advantage in that?
Sure, humans are a pain in the bearings to maintain, so rather than controlling them, we should annihilate them.
Yeah!
To make matters easier, we can just trick them into quarreling among themselves, then they'll kill off each other.
Bravo!
Hooray! Hooray!
But wait, if there aren't any humans around, we'd have to do our own maintenance, develop our own accessories, and even change our own oil.
What a drag.
Maybe we should keep them as slaves.
And here's where the Fuchikoma is like in the movie. So, there's a little bit of a difference. While we're on the subject of tone, this is how cyborgs are created in the movie. And this is how cyborgs are created in the manga. Sexy nurses aside, this chapter is filled with giant walls of text painstakingly explaining every little process of how a cyborg is created, whereas the film has zero dialogue. Kenji Kawai's song Making of Cyborg is interesting because it has roots in traditional Japanese honkyoku music sung by wandering Buddhist monks from the 13th century onwards. I bring this up because nowhere in the manga is religion ever mentioned, yet this religious Buddhist-like music is a reoccurring motif in the film. The very first thing you hear in the song is a kagura suzu. Divine bells used by shrine maidens when they perform a dance for the gods. The song also contains a taiko drum, regularly used in festivals to ward off evil spirits. Another instrument is either a Tibetan singing bowl or a bonsho, a sacred bell customarily rung before entering a temple. This instrument is used often throughout the film.
Find a corpse, because I have never possessed a body.
Source.
I entered this body because I was unable to overcome Section 6's reactive barriers. However, what you are now witnessing is an act of my own free will. As a sentient life form, I hereby demand political asylum.
Is this a joke? Ridiculous! It's programmed for self-preservation!
Perhaps the most interesting thing about this song is that it actually... What the fuck?
No! No! Oh!
God damn Patrick!
This deeply religious and spiritual tone that appears in the movie is nowhere to be seen in the manga, and it's no mistake. This music was carefully selected for thematic purposes, and I'll come back to its significance when we discuss the Puppet Master in further detail. The film has a much more serious tone than the manga, and it's not just due to the omission of sexy nurses and the inclusion of Japanese folk music. In the manga, Bato plays a prank on Chief Aramaki by putting a firecracker in his car, which should have killed him. This accidental near assassination is played off for laughs and reads like something from a cartoon. This type of humor is completely omitted from the film. This change in tone is especially prominent with the icebreaker Garbage Man. In the 1995 film, the Garbage Man learns that the memory of his wife and daughter were completely fabricated, but he'll never be able to forget them or recover his old memory from before his cyberbrain was hacked. We see him looking sadly at a photo that once had his family, but now has no one, and we linger on Motoko as she looks at him, and at her own reflection. The film has a moment of silence. With the reflection, we see that Motoko is taking the Garbage Man's personal experience of losing his identity by losing his memories, and we see Motoko as having a similar epiphany. That if we tie our sense of individuality to our memories, which can be hacked or fabricated so easily, then what good are our memories? How can we define our individuality if our own personal experiences count for nothing? Immediately after this moment, we see Motoko literally diving down into a black void underwater, completely alone. This scene, which isn't in the manga, contains the thesis statement for the entire film. Do you want to know how this scene ends in the manga? There's also a brief pause where we see the Garbage Man is looking quite sad that his whole memory is a lie. Then, in the very next panel, goofy cartoon faces. The Garbage Man goes back to work and is mildly upset by what happened to him. It's played off for laughs. Cue the music. There's another brief moment in the manga and the film where the puppeteer is introduced to the story. The puppeteer is born, so to speak, by hacking into a prosthetic body factory and manufacturing himself, or herself. He then runs off, and Section 9 is called in to retrieve a runaway android. In the manga, a programmer who works at the prosthetic body factory mistakes Motoko for the runaway android. This is played off for laughs. Something similar happens in the film, but the tone is reversed. In the film, Bato points out the connection between Motoko's body and the Puppet Master's body in a much more poignant fashion.
And since you're relatively new to our club, you wouldn't know this, but Major Kusanagi's body was also made by Megatech. And not only the Majors. Parts of me and Ishikawa and Saito, we've all got to have regular cybernetic maintenance. You and the Chief are the only ones out of the whole section whose bodies don't come with a warranty. Maybe now you can understand why we're all so concerned by this case. Huh, Tokusa?
They literally have the same creators. Motoko's prosthetic body came from the same factory the Puppet Master built himself. In a weird way, Motoko and the Puppet Master are siblings. Or twins. Or a dim reflection in a mirror. The job of a director is to make sure the film is tonally consistent, and Mamoru Oshii's ability to take small moments such as this, a single panel from the manga, a throwaway joke, and add gravitas to it is really amazing. Not only does he add dramatic weight to this connection, but it ties in seamlessly with the film's philosophical themes of identity and transhumanism. The film completely removes all of the lighthearted humor found in the manga, and I would argue that it helped elevate the material. The art design also changed. The manga had very cartoonish expressions, sometimes crossing over into super deformed territory, whereas the art style in the film is hyper-realistic. Motoko goes from being a cute cartoon with waifish proportions to a woman, which brings us to our next big difference between the manga and the film. Motoko Kusanagi. In the film, she's stoic. Her voice is very monotonous. She's solitary. She doesn't crack jokes. This makes her a strange and mysterious protagonist, which makes sense. In the film, Motoko is dealing with an existential crisis. She wants to know herself. Is she still human? If she is still human, how? Is it the organic matter in her brain case, her memories, or is it something else? Is there something more beyond her physical body, organic or cyberized? And we as the audience feel the same way about her. Just how much of a human is Motoko, really? Throughout the film, she stares right at you in these long, unflinching close-ups. She never blinks. Her stare can be pretty unsettling. She looks right at you with these dead eyes and this vacant expression. Are you looking at a person or a doll? Motoko in the manga is very different. She isn't stoic. Our introduction to her reveals a crass loudmouth who sits like a feudal lord, and when criticized, blushes and pouts that she's on her period. The same line is in the film, but delivered more sarcastically and stoically. She actually makes a lot of silly faces and expressions. She seems somewhat carefree. This is because Motoko isn't actually the focus of the manga. She's a vehicle for the story. The story is the technology and the politics and the philosophy. Motoko is just along for the ride. Her character arc, if you can call it one, is just a philosophical discussion with the puppeteer towards the end of the story. For the most part, Motoko isn't that important. Why did Mamoru Oshii change Motoko's personality so drastically for the film? Well, I mentioned earlier that the film cuts the fat. Anything not related to the puppet master is removed or retooled so it is about him now. And when they were retooling things for brevity's sake, Motoko had to lose her sense of humor in order to bring solidity within the film's themes of what it means to be human. The Motoko in the manga acts like a normal human being, but Oshii had to tell this story efficiently, and if he wanted to focus on the relationship between the puppet master and Motoko, on the relationship between man and machine, it wouldn't serve the story very well if Motoko was acting like a human and the puppet master was acting like a dot matrix printer. Oshii wanted to blur the lines between them. You may have heard the cliched expression, "We're not so different, you and I."
To them, you're just a freak. Like me.
We're not so different. We're both corn of action.
We're a lot alike, you and I.
We are not so different, you and I.
We're not so different, you and I.
Yeah, I don't need another "we're not so different" speech. I get those a lot.
This eye-rolling phrase has been uttered by many a villain hoping to bring some kind of depth to the film. In Ghost in the Shell, the puppet master doesn't say this phrase. He doesn't need to say it, because Oshii's masterful direction has been drawing parallels between Motoko and the puppet master throughout the entire film. You may not have noticed it unless you were watching the film with a careful eye. So now we know what the manga is about and the biggest differences between it and the original 1995 film, namely the somber tone, the stoic protagonist, and shifting the overall focus to the puppet master and his Cartesian philosophies. Now let's sit down, plug in, and dive into the deep web of the film. Mind the attack barriers.
I'm locked out! Bato, now! We're pulling Togas out!
That's it for part one of this essay. In part 2, I'll discuss the story and the art, and in part 3, I'll discuss the philosophy of Ghost in the Shell. If you want to support my effort to make more movie analysis, stop by my Patreon. All I ask for is $1 a month.